The golden age of motor racing is over. The age when factories all over Europe were producing new and experimental designs every year. With the coming of the Depression, the emphasis shifts to the drivers. Motor racing organizers meet the Depression by allowing drivers to use any size of car in the increasing number of Grand Prix races. In the Monaco Grand Prix, the lucky ones have either bought or borrowed supercharged straight-eight Bugattis. They are first, second and third. The winner, René Dreyfus, like many other drivers here, had to buy his own. The big British Bentleys are still winning sports car races. Some say the team includes five millionaires. Others say you need to be one to pay for the fuel. The Bentley boys, as they are called in the popular press, win the double 12 at Brooklands. They win again the following month at Le Mans, after a duel with Caracciola's even larger white German Mercedes. This is the last race ever of the Bentley Works team. Their days are over.
Well, we had nobody to beat but ourselves. So that was the best way of taking it. It was just touring. Is that right, Glenn?
That's right.
Tim Birkin, however, enters a private Bentley in the French Grand Prix. The French crowd are amused to see something rather like a lorry among their Bugattis. It is a pity that some of the only film left has been obscured by a misguided artist. For this is an epic battle, with Birkin and his 2 tons of Bentley up among the fastest. Towards the end, only Philippe Tansonin is in front of the British car, hurling his Bugatti into corners with an abandon as characteristic as his back-to-front cap. Tansonin is first, with Birkin less than 3.5 minutes behind after 245 miles. It's now the third French Grand Prix running, one in a Bugatti. It's getting monotonous. But there's a significant change when an Alfa Romeo team comes to Ireland for the tourist trophy, with the full backing of the factory and of an enthusiastic Mussolini. Nuvolari, Vazzi and Campari have been told to win, and they really try. Campari is called in to be reprimanded, but he just can't spare the time. The bigger cars are hopelessly out-handicapped. Even Birkin on the Bentley is to finish the day with his one and only racing crash. It's a tough day for all the independent drivers, and a complete victory for the Italian team. Nuvolari is first, Campari second, and Vazzi third. Tazio Nuvolari is only 5'2", but handles a car, when roused, with such verve that some say he has a pact with the devil. For the Targa Florio next year, Alfa Romeo have Campari and Nuvolari. Nuvolari has quarrelled with Vazzi, who has left Italy to drive a French Bugatti with a new twin-cam engine. The fast Italian Maseratis are also here. Vazzi, with his dress and his driving as immaculate as ever, takes the lead. The Alphas have front mudguards to protect the crew. And Enzo Ferrari is here together with 25 racing mechanics. The weather is deteriorating as Vazzi comes in for his last stop. He is blinded by the rain and mud. His neat helmet is changed for a peaked cap in a desperate attempt to shield his eyes. But now, Nuvolari is close and driving as if possessed. Borzacchini on another Alfa is also closing up. On the last 80-mile lap, Nuvolari goes tighter, driving to his utmost, defeating Vazzi by 7.5 minutes. The next round is the Italian Grand Prix at Monza. Vazzi has a Bugatti, Nuvolari an experimental 12-cylinder Alfa. Campari a smaller 8. Nuvolari for once doesn't get away first. Grand Prix races this year are a minimum of 10 hours and Vazzi leads for the first two. Nuvolari is third, struggling with the big car. Then Vazzi goes out, while Nuvolari takes a rest. Il Duce had told him to start and win, but his car has been withdrawn. However, Nuvolari isn't a man to be defeated, and he's back refueling Campari's Alfa before taking it over himself for a spell. Straight 8 comes in first, and in future will always be known as the Monza Alfa Romeo. The burly Campari and the tiny Nuvolari have between them driven nearly 1,000 miles. The Monza Alfas and the Maseratis now challenge the victorious Bugattis in the French Grand Prix at Montlhéry near Paris. Vazzi has teamed up for the 10-hour race with another of the great drivers, Louis Chiron, and they manage to keep up the Bugatti tradition of winning. Chiron jumps for joy, and even the doer Vazzi struggles to smile. Nuvolari is 11th. In sports car racing, Alphas pass all others on sheer speed. In the Tourist Trophy, Birkin has got his own, showing his skill as a driver, if not as a filling station attendant, by getting in front of the Alfa Works team. He regrets the lack of the right British car all the more at Le Mans when he and Earl Howe receive a telegram from Mussolini congratulating them on their win for Italy. In the Monaco Grand Prix, Vazzi and Nuvolari renewed their rivalry. There's a Monza Alfa in the white of Germany. It's Caracciola. He's given up Mercedes and joined the Alfa Works team. By 50 laps, Vazzi is out, and the crowd thrilled to see if Caracciola can catch Nuvolari. At the finish, Nuvolari leads his new teammate over the line by 3 seconds. It's the first time the Bugattis have ever been defeated at Monte Carlo. Caracciola takes his Monza Alfa to the Avis at Berlin. Germany is now in a state of financial collapse with 6 million unemployed, and there are no real German racing cars, although one Mercedes sports car has been fitted with a special streamlined body. The long straight roads of the Avis make it the fastest race in the world, and it takes its toll. Caracciola leads, but with all his skill on the corners, He can't get away from the streamlined car. Right at the end, the big Mercedes goes ahead. And Manfred von Brauchitsch, winning at over 120, becomes famous overnight. The P3 Alfa Romeos in the French Grand Prix at Reims are among the great racing cars of all time. All others are left behind as Nuvolari comes in first. Nuvolari on the P3 is virtually unbeatable. Even the twin-cam Bugatti, with Vazzi driving, cannot hold the new Alphas. Watch how Nuvolari gets away in the Monza Grand Prix. The Maseratis and the older Monza Alphas, with their slotted radiators, are left behind. The P3 Alphas win race after race, sweeping the board so completely that Alfa Romeo decide to withdraw their team of P3s and rest on their laurels. During the early 30s, the only other important racing is in the States. At Indianapolis, they are encouraging dwindling entries by allowing big engines to be used. It's real hairy racing. That's the famous Wilbur Shaw going over the top, and he's going to rejoin the race later in another car. A lot of people are very lucky not to get seriously hurt, as average speeds are now well over the 100 and going up steadily each year. But at last, the luck runs out, and five men are killed before Louis Mayer comes in on his Miller engine special to win for the second time. Mayer's great achievement has only been equaled once before by Tommy Milton.
Makes me feel more happy to win this than the first one, because I know we've done some good this time.
In Europe, Alfa Romeo sports car drivers continue to shine. The Mille Miglia is a fabulous race over 1,000 miles of the open roads, when the hazards that face each driver are equal only to those braved by the enthusiastic spectators. It is in the great tradition of the early city-to-city events. It is an achievement to finish, and if the car won't hold together, you must lend it a hand. Where else could you possibly see a car during a race being refueled by coal? Nuvolari is one of the immortals of the Mille Miglia, winning the race this year for the second time. Last year, he was champion of Italy, but the official withdrawal of Alfa Romeo with all their P3s is disastrous to his racing career. It is his rival Vazzi on the Bugatti who wins at Monaco. Vazzi wins again at Tripoli. When Vazzi's Bugatti wins in Berlin, the Nazis have just come to power. Adolf Hitler is here to see the Italian flag raised in triumph and lets it be known that he will award 500,000 Reichmarks for a successful German Grand Prix car. In the French Grand Prix, Nuvolari rockets into the lead. Nuvolari's car is a now outdated Monza Alfa, a and as so often this season, it is to failure. All the same, the winning car is Italian, the Maserati driven by Campari. This is Campari's greatest race, and he takes the opportunity to announce that this will be his last season. In future, he hopes to give more time to his other great loves, grand opera and good food. For the Italian Grand Prix, Nuvolari gives up the Alfa just as Ferrari gets hold of some P3s. All the same, Nuvolari, now on a Maserati, nearly wins, only to lose the race in the last laps when he has to change a burst tyre. A P3 Alfa is first, with Fagioli driving. Late on this same day, Campari brings out his Alfa for a minor race before his retirement. On the south bend, there is a patch of oil. Bozzacchini and Campari are both killed. The Italian newsreels salute them for the last time. So far, in the threadbare 30s, no Grand Prix cars have been built outside France and Italy. But people are getting a lot of pleasure with small sports cars. Others take their fun on the sands and find they bump into all sorts of people. On the new circuit at Donington Park, the enthusiast who likes to do his own last-minute tuning gets his chance. Given a great boost by the cheap and popular MG sports cars. So it isn't surprising to find Nuvolari himself in Belfast, trying one out in the Tourist Trophy, and giving it a glamour every bit equal to that of the British Prime Minister. The small MG midgets have three lap start, while Nuvolari's class with the larger engined MG magnets only get one lap. The Alphas and Invictas are on scratch. Nuvolari is soon way ahead of the rest of his class, but so is a wild, dark Irishman, Hugh Hamilton, on a midget. Before long, it is clear that the Irishman is leading the world-famous Italian by seconds and looks like winning. Nuvolari is still behind when Hamilton comes in for a disastrously slow pit stop. It becomes another national crisis as Nuvolari takes the lead. Nuvolari comes through to win the Tourist Trophy for the second time.
Specialmente per il molto pubblico che assiste a questa gara, che sono molto sportivi.
Mac, now would you just translate that? Mac? Mac? Mac?
This year at Indianapolis, it is reported that there aren't any serious accidents in the race, but it still can't be described as uneventful. Finally, Wild Bill Cummings passes Maury Rose to win by 27 seconds. As usual at Indianapolis, the winning car has a Miller engine, one of the most successful racing engines ever built. In Europe, Grand Prix racing comes back to its former glory with an effective new formula, a 750 kilogram weight limit. Here is a clear-cut challenge to engineering skill, and this contest for international prestige is watched by the crowned heads of Europe. Etoncelin has a perfected Maserati 8, Chiron, an improved P3 Alfa Romeo. The 3.3 Bugatti is a new design and one of the most beautiful racing cars ever built. Chiron is way ahead on the Alfa, and it looks an easy win. But on the last lap, he makes one of his rare mistakes. It is another of the new Alphas that crosses the line with a brilliant young driver from Algeria, Guy Moll. This long supremacy of Italian cars is at last to be challenged on the Arvis in Berlin by rear-engined auto unions, the first new racing cars of the Third Reich. The revolutionary silver cars, weighing well under a ton, have engines producing nearly 300 horsepower, and von Stuck is leaving the Alphas behind. The new German cars have streamlined bodies. The lessons of von Brauchitsch's win 2 years ago have been noted. Somewhere behind von Stuck, there's a single streamlined Alfa driven by Guy Moll. The auto unions are coming into the pits. Guy Moll takes the lead. The tremendous power of the auto unions is hard on the rear tires now that the road is drying. The race becomes a triumph for Guy Moll on the streamlined Alfa. Vazzi is second, while in fourth place, and almost unnoticed, and most gallant of all, is Nuvolari, who has driven the race with a broken leg in plaster. Alphas have won this round. But 5 weeks later in the French Grand Prix, the finest cars of France and Italy are to meet a double challenge from the new Germany. Besides the auto unions, team manager Neubauer is here with three Mercedes. Their engines have over 300 horsepower, and all four wheels are sprung independently. With them are experts on tires, fuel, and carburation. These cars are being driven by Fagioli, the winner of the last Italian Grand Prix. Von Brauchitsch, the victor at Arvis. And Caracciola, the greatest German driver of all time. In practice, both German and Italian cars break the lap record by 3 seconds, then by 4, then 6, 7, 11, 12, and finally by over 13 seconds. The Italian and French cars have work support, but no one has ever gone racing before with an organization as large or as thorough as this. A record crowd of 80,000 is arriving. The race is to be 300 miles long, and at least one man is prepared to eat it through. This is the first Mercedes team to visit France since 1914, and the prestige of Hitler's Germany is at stake. Chiron's Alfa come up from the third row. Caracciola's Mercedes is now in front, Chiron is second. It's Chiron. Caracciola is second. The incredible Chiron is drawing away from the Mercedes. What can Neubauer be thinking? Chiron's Alfa still leads as von Stuck, on an auto union, moves up into second place for a new German attack. With a lap record of over 90, the German auto union goes into the lead for the Third Reich. Most impressive of all is the road holding of the German cars and the way they seem to float over the concrete surface. All other cars appear obsolete as they bounce and bucket along. But all isn't well with the new cars. Von Brauchitsch's Mercedes is slowing with supercharger trouble. Another Mercedes is coming in. It's Caracciola. A near side tire is smooth, and look how narrow the brake drums are for such a fast and powerful car. Chiron is again in the lead, but now Fagioli's Mercedes is right on his tail. Chiron goes faster than ever and sets another lap record, while Fagioli finds those brakes fading. The auto unions are also having trouble. And Vazzi brings another Alfa into second place. The German attack is broken. The race is another demonstration of Alfa Romeo invincibility, with Vazzi and Gaimol in second and third place. The French crowd are delighted, for the leader wears the blue of France, their Louis Chiron. Louis Chiron's greatest victory is the peak of Alfa Romeo fortune. But this is the last time for many years that any car will outperform the new Mercedes and auto unions. Motor racing has entered the age of the highly organized team, dedicated to national prestige. The great days of the independent driver are over.